I thought it might have been one for the Caps, but it just didn't transpire that way. Were you surprised that it wasn't something that kind of lit a fire underneath Ovi's teammates?
Yeah, I don't know that it backfired per se. You know, you could say that sometimes. You were trying to ignite the rally on your team. Your team was under pressure. The fan base here was amazing. The atmosphere was electric. The Caps really didn't seem to have their best game going at that time, although I rewind that tape, and I really liked the first couple of minutes. I said this to Chad yesterday, that I thought in the first couple of minutes that the Ovechkin line with Backstrom and Wilson was playing extremely well. I thought they were going to break the ice again and grab the lead. It didn't happen, and from there, everything went south. I don't know that the Ovechkin fight backfired in that sense, but I know from now on, they're going to use it as a rallying cry, and that's just, hey, you know, you would use that on, any team would do that. Oh, he beat up our teenager. Well, that's going to be their rallying cry? Good. Well, I'm not sure if that's going to be enough, and I don't think that's technically accurate at all in that this was a mugging, or that this was a one-sided, he didn't want to go. He obviously wanted to go. He was throwing punches, and I'm giving you the description of Chirper coming from other conversations that I've heard that didn't necessarily involve Ovechkin. There are other players on the Caps who say, yeah, this kid's running around a little bit. Okay, he learned a lesson.
Did you see this coming? Not the blowout per se, but did you feel like sort of after the first two games, the Caps were fortunate to be up 2-0 and that, you know, that they were Carolina was playing better than their results. And this was in maybe coming. Did you see that?
Absolutely. Yeah, EB. I thought Carolina could have, would have, should have gained a split in those first two games in D.C. I thought Washington played really well in the second 10 minutes of the first period. You think about the 3-0 lead and how quickly the power play struck with, like, expert precision. But since that first couple of power plays, they've gone cold. Special teams have been dominated by Carolina since. And the overtime game, you know, that becomes a crapshoot. Carolina rallies to tie it in the third on a power play goal, by the way, to get you across the finish line. To me, that's championship experience and wherewithal, and that's great. That's also taking advantage of home ice, which I loved. I was all about Washington coming to Carolina with a 2-0 lead. The Canes had 46 wins, EB. I mean, they had 99 points. It's a really good hockey team. It's an incredibly good Eastern Conference. Just ask Columbus and Tampa. You know, everybody in the East is good, and everybody can beat anybody. So I thought the Caps would take this in six. I'd like to see it end in less than six, especially now that New York has done what it did to Pittsburgh. But, you know, I have a lot of respect for Carolina. I think they have a really good game. I love their defense. The crowd here in the last half of the season, I was told, was terrific. We saw them at PNC Arena late in March. They were very good, but nothing like what they were in Game 3. That was an amazing atmosphere in Game 3. So I know that the Caps have their hands full for tomorrow night.
Joined by Joe Beninati, play-by-play voice for the Capitals on NBC Sports Washington on the Mattress Warehouse Hotline. You know, we're used to seeing the Rangers, Flyers, Pens, Lightning, teams like that on the playoff path. The Canes are a new one, and before the series, I was saying to myself, how am I going to build up like a lather like for this team that we don't really have a rivalry with? But Brian McNally, your colleague at NBC Sports Washington, our friend, we all know Brian, he penned a really good article. It's entitled, How Game 3 Might Have Finally Ignited a Caps-Hurricanes Rivalry. So maybe that fight between Ovi and Svechnikov, maybe that was the flashpoint that really starts a rivalry for these two fan bases going down the road.
No doubt. And I thought, you know, when I was having discussions with Locker, with Alan May, with Brent Johnson leading into this series, we all felt that Washington was the more physical team. And that's not to say that Carolina was a group of wallflowers by any stretch, but we didn't expect them, I don't think, to play with the ferocity that they played with in Game 3. I mean, it was incredible, and especially when you lose Svechnikov earlier in the game, and Michael Ferland, who's probably their toughest, most equipped power forward, also doesn't play for the balance of that game. They were two men down for that entire game, and it looked like they were playing with 30 guys, not 10. And they were everywhere in Washington's face. And that was a complete forechecking clinic. And if there's anything that Washington needs to respond and react to better in Game 4, It's the Canes' forecheck. And this is the beauty of playoff hockey, guys. You have the time in between to reset, to focus, to check your countermeasures, what needs to be done. You know, so it becomes the chess match. There's your move. Okay, great. Now we're going to respond. And you hope that you have the right plan in place for tomorrow night to, first of all, you need to counteract that forecheck. That forecheck was dazzling. And it's, like I said, it looked like they had seven guys on the ice all the time.